Our guest today is Nabila Jamshed, who's a political columnist, a writer par excellence, and a novelist. She's been writing for the Indian Express Group and the Hindustan Times. She has worked with the UNESCO, the OPCW, and is now on her way for the United Nations peacekeeping operations in Africa. We welcome you. It is indeed a pleasure having you here with us, Nabila.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be on the show.
How you drive an entire industry out of business, and one in particular. The industry that I'm talking about is a massive global enterprise, employs thousands of people around the world, is run by both multinationals and national operations, by several startups in fact. It's worth hundreds of billions in US dollars, and the only product that it manufactures is death. So what is this industry that I'm talking about? The industry of war, and I use war more as a literary device here. What I'm talking about, it really is armed conflict between groups, between states and groups, between groups and society, between any two groups of people who use war and armed conflict as a means to gain either economic power, more territory, political power, and all of those things.
I'd like to know about your early life and education, and we'd like to share it with the viewers.
Of my early life and education, I think the most interesting thing I can say about that has been it's very nomadic, because
absolutely, a
civil servant family, so I've been moving around with my dad all over the country. I've switched a number of schools, and it's, I think, led into my nomadic lifestyle now, which is, you know, to go from one place to another and be interested in a lot of different contexts, you know. And similarly, I've attended a lot of schools, like I said, and then finally I came to Delhi, so I've been here for a couple of years now, and then I've been moving to...
I believe you're from Mount Carmel, right?
Carmel Convent School, Carmel here Convent, in Delhi. That's right.
And later you graduated from the Lady Shri Ram College.
I did go there, yes. Lady Shri Ram College, Delhi University.
And you did political science,
that was my subject there. So I studied political science with a subsidiary course in economics, and that is, I consider that the, you know, where my interest in international politics really germinated firmly into bringing me into the field of security and international development today.
I think that's the best place to pursue a degree in political science, right?
It absolutely is. It was such a wonderful experience. So the faculty and the kind of options that you get, I could study the United Nations in detail because I wanted to do that as one of my electives. So it was quite a great place to do that. And, you know, all the extracurricular world of LSR is so extensive. So
You kind of foray into so many other things.
Absolutely,
right?
Yes. You know, you get to do debates, you get to do these model United Nations assemblies, get really, you know, first-hand experience
Charged
of what that world
yes.
would be like once
and
you
join. And MUNs are really interesting because you get a first-hand knowledge of every country. It's not necessarily
right.
that you represent your own country, right? So it can be Greece or Africa or any other place. And for that, I think you need to learn the whole thing backwards to be able to counter, you know, the mock security council and things like that, right?
Absolutely. I think the most interesting thing about these simulations that students go through is not just that they have to understand the issues, but they are for the first time confronted with the actual challenges of negotiating that diplomatically. Because otherwise, you know, when you're sitting in a classroom, you don't get a good sense of... you know, your own national interest will come into play when you're talking about this issue. So it's not idealistic. You have to consider your constituency back home. You have to think about the different government departments and how they would react. So it's quite useful.
And now they've forayed into youth parliaments as well.
They have, yes. And I've done a couple of those as well. Youth parliament assemblies.
It's,
you know,
even more interesting.
That's even more interesting because there you have to really familiarize yourself with the nitty-gritties of the
party manifesto, what they're trying to
absolutely.
Say and how you portray it outwards.
Absolutely.
After this, you had a stint at Oxford University.
I did, yes. So,
and you did...
Global governance and diplomacy.
And diplomacy, right.
Diplomacy, yes. I did my master's there. So I went to Oxford, you know, to sort of channel further this expertise in international relations. And I wanted to study organizations in particular with the objective of working for an agency like the United Nations, trying to understand the multilateral process in more detail. And Oxford was a wonderful place to do that. Their Department of International Development has this program that, you know, really lets you get into not just, you know, conventionally, United Nations systems or regional organizations, but also something as interesting as private military companies, for example, or corporations, and how they are instruments of global governance and feeding into, the world of security and conflict around the world.
It teaches you so much in that internship, what you do, is that you get a picture of the whole thing. So it kind of fits in later into your scheme of things.
Yes, absolutely. So when you get a good sense of how this work is being done in a lot of different areas, when I entered the United Nations, it was working for education for peace and sustainable development. So I worked with UNESCO first, and then I went on to chemical weapons disarmament. And with all of these, I could see it was the same processes. It was the same interplay of national interest. It was the same ideals that everyone was trying to project. So it was a good, if you study something as broad as global governance and international relations, a lot of people tell you when you're young that you should specialize in a particular field, but I think it's a very good idea to get a broad sense of everything that's happening in the world.
Tell me about your home. Like, who's inspired you at home? Your father, your mother?
I think both of them, have been very encouraging and really nurtured the talents that I wanted to pursue and, the things that I wanted to do with my dreams. They're both, very creative people, have a lot of intellectual interests. So, it's been
they're
great.
They're both working, right?
Yes, they're both working. And so it's been, great getting their support and advice on what I needed to do. And the best part is to have the freedom to pursue, things that I wanted
your
to do
dreams.
As well.
Yes,
absolutely.
And honing your talents 24/7, you're not, writing things. So what
sure.
else?
Oh, I'm afraid that a lot of the stuff that I do is very boring and similar to what I do in my professional life. So I have always been, immersed in a lot of literature. I read. I also write. I've written fiction before.
I want to compliment you on your book, Wish Upon a Time.
Thank you very
much. It's in international stores even now. I mean, people can get a copy of it from there. And
thank
what
you.
A wonderful thing you've achieved by writing such a book. I mean, who inspired you to write this?
So I've always been interested in, dabbling with some sort of writing. And all of us do, I think, when we are kids.
Yeah.
Everyone writes poetry, everyone writes stories. But I think I took it a little bit more seriously because by the time I got to the end of school, I wanted to put it together in a 300-page volume, a metaphorical story of, what if our international problems were in this fantasy
world. And it's
world.
A kind so of a fantasy.
It is right? a fantasy, yes. So it was meant for very young audiences. And I wrote that. It was published when I was in college. That was quite an interesting experience to do that. And I hope, I'll have the time to continue doing that. In the
Are you writing
well.
Another one?
Yes, certainly. I mean, I'm kind of exploring
in
the idea
process.
Of writing. In the process, yes.
And what else do you do in your free time whenever you get time at home?
Gardening,
dancing, music, anything like that?
I do enjoy art of different kinds. So, there's music and there's cinema and I like to travel. I've had the good fortune of being in, of having had the opportunity to live in Europe apart from here. So, trying to explore new places and appreciating the history of cities.
Did you find a change in, when you studied at Oxford vis-a-vis LSR? Is there kind of a difference between, studying abroad, so as to say, what is that one thing that you feel, you can share with us?
I think they both have their own respective strengths, the kind of education systems we have. The main difference that I found was at Oxford, there was a lot of emphasis on learning from each other. Apart from the expertise that you get from
that
a very
peer
formidable
learning,
faculty.
Right.
Absolutely. So a lot of it was, either getting together in study groups or, these systems of
collaborative
learning. We make, presentations, you would read something, but you were not, wouldn't just get a lecture on it, but you were expected to present your interpretation of what you had learned to your, to your broader class. So I thought that was it. But other than that, I think in terms of the opportunities that you get to, when you're at a place like Oxford, you're essentially learning from the same people that you're reading, who've written your textbooks on that subject. So that was quite, I think,
So
in
you're
terms
always
of
in awe of them.
You are. You kind of feel like you're in an academic Disneyland almost. Mm. Everyone is an academic celebrity. So I think I was very fortunate to have had that experience.
And after that, you joined UNESCO, right?
Yes. So after that, I worked briefly with the OPCW, and then I joined UNESCO.
Tell
us
about OPCW.
So OPCW, where I've also worked last, so I went back to the OPCW after UNESCO again. which is the agency that implements the Chemical Weapons Convention. So it's in charge of chemical weapons disarmament around the world. It is one of the largest international organizations. It's also one of the largest disarmament treaties that it implements. So it's done very well. It won a Nobel Prize for its efforts in 2013. And it can say now that it has successfully overseen the destruction of over 90% of the world's chemical weapons. So that was a very useful experience for me to be able to see multilateralism, about which there is so much pessimism in general, especially among the younger generations, in action and doing so well, and somehow able to bring together the voices of 192 countries.
193, I believe.
192 for the OPCW at the moment. Okay. And to bring them together and to have all of them agree that chemical weapons should be disarmed and to willingly give up their arsenals and commit themselves to the principle that chemical weapons and poison will never be used in war again, really reaffirms your idealism in the system, I think, especially for, a young person like me who's working in this field now. Really reaffirms your faith in the system that if we do get together as countries, there are some ideals that we can aspire to achieve too.
$1,765 billion is annually what is spent on military expenditures around the world by states and non-state actors. 33, the number of armed conflicts currently raging globally. 875 million small arms are in circulation around the world today. And perhaps the most dangerous number of all, 20,500, that's the number of nuclear heads all the nuclear powers of the world currently possess. And just to put things in perspective, let me give you another amusing number, $2.5 billion. $2.5 billion, compare that to this $1,765 billion. $2.5 billion is the total United Nations annual regular budget for peace and security, humanitarian and international law put together.
You know, when we talk of disarmament, we also have to keep the nation's perspective in mind.
Absolutely.
Coming to your defenses, you have a defense system in place. In the sense, as a nation, you need to build up your defenses just in case something happens. You have to be fully equipped for any kind of an offense. Offensive thing against you. So how do you counter that? You know, these are two things where we need to really think hard, because on one hand we are buying arms, rockets, space missiles, smart bombs, what have you, and on the other hand we talk about disarmament.
That has been the eternal debate between national strategic interest of a state, which because of political reasons, the way that your neighborhood is, calls for defenses to be strengthened, versus the whole ideal that once we give up our weapons, we will begin to put conflict out of commission. And this is why it's very important that disarmament effort has to be international. You know, security can only be collective. If you have most of the states around the world gather together and mutually agree that they will give up a certain category of weapons, that is when your efforts are most likely to succeed. So for example, with chemical weapons disarmament, I mean, if one country had unilaterally decided to give up their chemical weapons, that might not have been an easy sell to the constituency back home. But, when you have a group of countries that come together and all of them agree to have a system of international verification in place, an external agency that is going to oversee
monitor
this, a neutral,
thing,
yes, a group of neutral experts who will make sure that disarmament is being carried out, that then puts it, that makes it your strategic security interest then to get rid of your weapons. Because if you don't do that, then you're automatically, one of the, you're one of the outsiders. Then you have to justify why you still have those weapons. So I think that it's, then it becomes in your national strategic interest to say we've given up our chemical weapons or we've given up our nuclear weapons. So like you said, the only way to reconcile, national interest versus disarmament is to have a global security effort that does these things.
We have to come together as a,
absolutely,
global and community and
yes,
think about it.
That makes most sense to national interest, is to have it articulated as an international interest.
Tell me, who were you inspired by when you did political science?
Oh, there was just so, there is a great depth of work in, different kinds of philosophers trying to understand different things. So But among the people that I really enjoyed that I think have a lot of policy relevance, for example, the Rawlsian theory of justice, I think the veil of ignorance, very generally speaking.
American.
Very generally speaking is a good, rule of thumb going ahead, designing any sort of, a convention or an ideal treaty. I was also inspired by the Hobbesian, concept of civil society being created when people give up their rights to a common sovereign. I think that has not
relevance.
That not in its absolute sense, but for the international world also, there's the same guiding principles.
Yes.
Yeah, if we give up some of our rights and some of our obligations to a central organization that can help us pursue those, then that's a good idea.
But so, how many are willing to do that?
Oh, great deal. I think 193 as far as the UN is concerned, more than that as far as some of the UN agencies go. So a lot of states have put
because after
themselves.
We've seen the debacle and the catastrophe of the Hiroshima, Nagasaki, nuclear holocaust, it's so sad that even today we're not, trying to, like I'm reminded of Kofi Annan when he said, that we are going to wipe our past, present and future completely if we don't begin to take this seriously and if we don't begin to give away chemical weapons and all these arsenals, then there's nothing we're going to leave for our, generations. There will be no generations henceforth. So, but it's easier said than done. So that is the question we are now going to look at. How is it possible, and what kind of nuclear waste, what kind of nuclear weapons are we talking about? If you could please enlighten our viewers about that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the basic principle of disarmament is that if you get rid of the supply of a certain kind of conflict, whether it's nuclear warfare or chemical warfare, then you automatically eliminate the possibility of that sort of conflict from occurring. So, a lot of people say that disarmament follows peace, but I think there's some merit to saying that disarmament actually precedes peace, and that peace is built on disarmed arsenals of states. So, in that sense, just you were right to mention Hiroshima and Nagasaki, two of the darkest episodes of human history that have gone a long way in informing the decisions of states not to deploy these weapons. So, nuclear weapons have not been used since. It's the same thing with the history of chemical weapons, because they were used, in places like the Iran-Iraq war, for example. They were used in Tokyo on a subway by terrorist actors. And then, there was a, growing recognition that they should never be used again, because these are agents of mass destruction. When you deploy them, they don't discriminate between a combatant, a soldier in uniform and somebody who's a civilian. They don't discriminate. Once you've deployed a nuclear weapon, destruction is absolute and complete. So, of course, this is something that the world is
looking at,
dealing
yes.
with.
Yes.
And I think our success so far has been that weapons of mass destruction, at the very least, have become a question of taboo. Uh-huh. They haven't been used. Their use has become very, very exceptional, especially with the nuclear weapons.
But in the guise of building defenses, it is still there.
It's still there. It's become more of a metaphor for this is the defense capability we have, rather than as a viable option of use because of mutually assured destruction.
Let's look at conflict, Nabila. In my opinion, the conflict starts with inequality. Do you agree with this? And if so, can you tell us some more about this?
I think there is some merit to inequality being one of the reasons that catalyzes conflict at some level. But if you look at the history of warfare over the last few centuries, you will increasingly find that this has moved from beyond battlefields and countries fighting each other to being non-state actors fighting states, or militias and ethnic groups and terrorist groups fighting each other. So most conflicts that are raging today have become non-state conflicts. They don't involve governments, or they are one government and one non-governmental group fighting, or they've become things like terrorism, which again have their roots in a lot of developmental challenges,
inequality
again at the national level, at the regional level, and for various ideological reasons. So there are a number of factors that feed into it, and what is important for the international system now to do is to really try to separate, instead of these very ad hoc responses where you only deal with a particular conflict when it breaks out, either by strengthening the defenses there or through a military sort of a solution.
But we haven't been able to stop a war in Syria for the last 5 years. It's still raging,
isn't it? The war in Syria very tragically has been raging for a few years. And, you know,
Yemen
as
now?
You know, chemical weapons were also used in Syria in 2013. That has been established.
Look at the state of the people there. I mean, I'm reminded of that. I wonder if you've read the poem, Refugee. It's so sad. I mean, when they're running out from there and they're going into a country and they do not have a country to call their own.
Absolutely.
And is the world looking, really?
Absolutely. I think a lot of states, you know, in Europe, for example, have taken, you know, the initiative to welcome
Greece.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Germany has, and, you know, even countries like Canada, you know, far out, even outside of Europe, have taken, you know, good steps in this direction. The refugee crisis, I think, is a great example of, you know, demonstrating to us where conflicts in one part of the world become directly entwined with our own national interests and with our own sense of ethical responsibility towards the victims of that conflict. Absolutely. So then it doesn't matter what your boundaries are and what state you belong to and what your own interest is. I think when you're dealing with a person who's stateless and homeless, who's lost everything, you know, as somebody very rightly said, you know, recently, I forget who it is, but someone very rightly said, you know, you would only go out, you know, you would only take your family out to the sea if the sea is safer than your home. Mm. I mean, there's nobody who would voluntarily put themselves on a boat at that, you know, on a risk of dying on the way. And we've seen the image of the boy who died on the shores of Turkey when he reached there, Elan Kurdi. And that was one of the images that really jolted the world into action. But that's a good example of how our efforts need to go a little bit beyond borders. We need to talk, you know, to each other, not as, you know, governments and states, but as people, global citizens of the world.
Can you tell me about maritime conflicts? Because this is what is happening these days. Conflict in waters, in territories like Japan, even after whatever it's gone through, is still facing it in the South China Sea.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, other than the strategic importance of these maritime zones for countries, which is why they become agents of dispute, water is sort of the next battle zone for a lot of our, you know, regional conflicts and more local conflicts as well. So that's something that, you know, international organizations
have to...
So we
need to safeguard, Every nation is now getting into this kind of a...
Absolutely, absolutely. And especially with the United Nations' new focus on sustainability, with the setting of the new Sustainable Development Goals, for the next 15 years, I think a lot of our resources and the conflicts that wage over resources are going to become a lot more central to our security discourse. I mean, initially you had talked about, you know, the root causes of conflict and whether inequality is one of them. I would argue that resources always play a very critical role when it comes to, you know, groups taking up arms against each other.
How relevant is United Nations as far as this goes? Because in my opinion, and it's strictly my opinion, I find it's being strong-armed by a lot of other developed nations.
I think the United Nations is, you know, the sort of the instrument of multilateralism for the world. And to paraphrase one of the scholars who said this about the World Bank or one of the UN agencies, if we didn't have United Nations, we would have to create it. You know, so it's the way in which 193 states are able to cooperate with each other on every single issue that is of common interest to them.
Sustainable development, economic,
absolutely,
social
absolutely.
Progress.
And the just the scale of work that the United Nations has done over the last 70 years, it's celebrating 70 years.
It's commendable.
Absolutely. Whether it's security or, you know, sending in peacekeepers to maintain ceasefires during conflicts, supporting education policy, supporting development, helping industry, you know, protecting the environment. There's just no parallel to that. So I think that the relevance of the United Nations continues to, you know, only be strengthened in the future when there are more grounds for us in a more globalized and connected world to convene rather
but
than
yet,
less.
But yet, we need to safeguard nations taking unilateral decisions, don't you think so?
I think, you know, the more that states are able to...
That's the opine of a lot of them.
That's, you know, of course, you know, in any multilateral system, you know, the interplay of who has more resources will always come into play. But the principles of the UN so far, you know, especially in the General Assembly, or if you see, you know, smaller agencies that are within the larger United Nations family, for example, you know, the OPCW, for example, are trying to take more and more decisions on the basis of consensus and are trying to take a lot more decisions on the basis of, you know, everyone's vote should matter and, you know, everyone's voice should count.
From bullets to ballots.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, channeling it into those areas, trying to get more and more, you know, views from the ground, working in the field, getting the views not only of small states, but also the ordinary people who are direct recipients of the UN's work.
Yes. Rural areas is, even in India, I think it's very, very effective.
Yes.
When we look at terrorism, now, people are radicalizing a lot of youth on the internet these days. It's not just physical contact and you become a terrorist. So, since you rightly said that this is the main thing that United Nations is looking at, so can you tell our viewers if there is some kind of a policy that you have made which kind of looks into these kind of things and stops people from giving away their precious lives instead doing something, you know, productive with their lives?
I think that you very rightly said that terrorism is a lot more complex than a lot of conflict issues that we faced in our history. And its complexity really comes from the fact that it's not, as you said, about physical contact between two people. There are networks that are built online. There are networks that are, you know, ideological as well, not just about resources, not just about, you know.
It's about religion.
It's about you
ideology.
Know, they draw on a lot of these different sources to try to have this dialogue that encourages violent ideology around the world. So what, you know, an agency like the United Nations or, you know, in any state level, when you counter a problem that's as complex as that, you have to address it at all different levels. So it needs to be attacked at the level of, you know, for example, education. If you said young people are being radicalized by the voices and opinions they hear on channels like the internet that they have access to freely, then why don't we go into their classrooms and give them, you know, the opposite ideas? I mean, that's something that Malala Yousafzai has been talking about recently, you know, that education is the best tool for with which we counter extremist ideology.
But let's remember, she took a bullet in her head to make the world wake up and say, okay, this is Malala.
Absolutely. And I mean, that was one of the, that was a profound tragedy that really alerted us to, as basic a right as getting an education for children can be threatened by, you know, violence. So, and violence and extremist ideology. So, like I said, it has to be addressed at every level, addressed at education. It needs to be addressed in our development policies. You know, we need to create the sort of equitable development policies in every state and every region so that nobody has to say that I have nothing to lose, so I'll join a violent movement. Absolutely. You know, either the feeling of deprivation or saying that I have nothing to lose. So you need to make policies where young people feel invested, you know, in the roads and bridges of their countries. They look at it and they say, I have a stake in this. So I can't, you know, just randomly go and join a violent movement that destroys these things. And it has to be developed, you know, in our legal processes, you know, better justice systems. It has to be addressed at the level of, you know, better interstate dialogue. It also needs to be addressed in, I think, cultural institutions, which are being used now to perpetuate terrorist ideology, you know. So, you know, in religious places,
and
in cultural.
And why don't we start disarmament education in our universities?
Absolutely. I think, you know, the classrooms are where this generation gets its first ideas.
Yes.
So, you know, what you can put...
what stays.
I don't want to say put in the minds of people, but you know what children engage with at that level is something that stays with them for a long time. So,
and I think the United Nations is doing a lot in this. We have workshops, we have poster making, we have seminars, we have the mock MUNs, and there's so much going that to spread this kind of awareness among every class from rural to urban, and all the schools are taking this forward in their own way. And very recently, our Prime Minister, when he addressed the Security Council, Mr. Modi said that we need to make the Security Council more credible by strengthening it at all levels. So I think that is also another thing we need to look at.
Absolutely. I think for the first part of your question, is the UN has done a lot on, you know, education that is specifically targeted at building peace and sustainable development. So, you know, not just, you know, in terms of workshops and things, but very specific efforts trying to engage with curriculums, advising governments on education policy. And I worked with UNESCO, so I can speak from my personal experience in UNESCO as well as the MGIP where I worked, which is the new institute in New Delhi. You know, the effort is to engage with education at every level. Even the teaching methods should be, you know, something that encourage sustainability and peace. On your second point, you talked about Mr. Modi's, you know, about strengthening the Security Council and making it more credible. I think that is absolutely the need of the hour. Strengthening the United Nations as an institution, and Prime Minister Modi has made absolutely the right, you know, statements when he did address the General Assembly, saying that that should be, you know, that is very important to us in terms of where decisions are taken about matters of mutual interest, about how the international community gets together. And I think strengthening that institution is really the right way to go. It's about, you know, giving it more responsibility, giving it more credibility so that it's perceived as more credible by all the countries around the world. And also, of course, you know, the reform of the Security Council is a debate that continues to go on, and hopefully, you know, with the leadership of countries like India, that's something that that debate will go in a positive direction.
No, ahimsa is so central to our worldview.
Yes,
but he also mentioned another thing, that we need to ban terrorism of any sort, even when they have protection by the state.
Mm-hmm.
And so did our external affairs minister. She said that recently.
Right.
So, how does the UN look at banning these kind of terrorist organizations? You can't go everywhere.
Absolutely. And I think one of the most important things here is to realize that an institution of global governance is basically just a group of states. You know, a non-state actor, a terrorist actor, is not a member of the UN. So, you know, how do you enforce the UN's rules on...
They have no rules.
Yeah, exactly. On a non-state actor, on, you know, a terrorist
That's
organization.
Exactly, yes.
And what you can do and what
we
international organizations are doing is to build the capacity of states, of their members, to deal with these problems better. So whether it's at the legal level, whether it is to secure defenses...
Or their
whether
funding.
It is to, well, yes, absolutely. Whether it is to combat the ideology, whether it is to combat their networks, you know, how they're... So, you know, you have cooperation at, for example, the Interpol level, which is the, you know, the UN's international police organization, or you know, at the level of development agencies getting together, the, you know, providing channels for states to draw up anti-terrorism treaties, you know, that help you know, establish laws and norms of how states can't back, you know, violent actors, terrorist organizations, how you have to make sure that they don't get access to your weapons as a state, especially your weapons of mass destruction. That has been a challenge, you know, even with chemical disarmament and nuclear disarmament as well. You know, so states not only have to be careful that they don't actively support, but they also have to be careful they don't accidentally end up, you know, their arsenals can't accidentally leak to terrorist actors either. So it has to be a multi-level approach. And I think, you know, the more channels that are created at the United Nations for states to cooperate on this, the better it is, because then we can share information with each other, and we can, you know, if you're dealing with an international network, then you can't deal with it as one state by yourself. You have to deal with it at the international level.
Looking at it from a gender lens,
yes.
Nabila, what are the things we now need to do, since you worked with the UNESCO as well? What are the things we need to do for empowerment of women? Because I see, again, I'm going back to Prime Minister Modi when he had that, you know, selfie with daughter
right.
Campaign, which went viral in minutes. I mean, what a wonderful way of instilling pride in your girl child, father and daughter. So what are the measures that, you know, this was a wonderful idea that he had and he implemented it. What are the measures we need to take now to take this even more forward? Because when you talk of women in India, a lot of them are deprived of even the basic amenities.
Absolutely. And I think I'm very glad you brought this up. This is something that's very close to my heart, because I find it absolutely appalling that in 2015, you know, if you racism is considered such a taboo, you can't absolutely, you know, you can't do it. There are laws against, you can't make a racist joke or, you know, something that, you know, goes against a particular person of a religion or any other identity. But if you make a sexist joke, it's fine. You know, sexism is still something that we consider normal rather than something that's completely abhorrent. So I think the more mainstream we make the feminist struggle for better rights, and I proudly call myself a feminist, you know, with, especially with Prime Minister Modi, somebody of that level intervening directly, making it a personal effort to have a campaign like Selfie with Daughter is quite commendable. And I think that's something that we need to take a lot more seriously, because
there's lots that can be done.
It's literally, it's 50% of the world.
Yes,
it's 50% of the world that faces a lot of different kinds of discrimination and injustice. And a lot of it is not very visible either. It's not direct. Mm. You know, it's not like you're telling a woman that she can't enter a particular workforce, but then you put so many limitations on her, you know, in the household, in the kind of education she gets, in the societal pressure
she's
that she has.
She's actually chained, yes.
If she's feeling unsafe about taking public transport, for example, then obviously you are putting restrictions on her, even though the office doesn't say, there's no board outside that says women are not allowed.
No, but the irony in India is that you revere a woman as a goddess, a Saraswati and a, you know, Durga and something like that. And then this all happens.
Which is really strange, because that suggests to us that, you know, our cultural traditions were probably more benign, because, women were automatically afforded goddess status without any questions about their capabilities. And today we are questioning the capabilities of people who are...
So we need to look back in our past and then take the glories.
Absolutely. Yes. There might be some very useful lessons in our past that we are not really looking at today that might really help us, build better institutions and support networks for women to be able to do what they want to do with their lives.
What about United Nations in Africa, where you're now going to be currently serving? Mm-hmm. How do you see that? Because the UN mission is in Liberia, it's in Sudan, it's in Congo, and all these places. So how do you see that opening out, if you can share that with us?
I think the United Nations peacekeeping efforts, not just in Africa, but in, you know, wherever in the world they are, initially what was, you know, meant to be a way of maintaining a ceasefire or a buffer zone has now gone into a lot of different areas of work. You know, it's these missions have expanded into something that is helping countries maintain law and order, actively protecting civilians, helping them build democratic institutions, helping them build the rule of law. You talked about from bullets to ballots, so helping them have these fair democratic elections that can build transitional authorities. So, you know, the objective of UN peacekeeping in that sense is to give the capability back to the people of that country from, you know, especially when there are no options left, when they've been at war for so long.
From a tyrant, a monarch, or whatever.
If they've been at war for so long that they don't have institutions. So, you know, help them rebuild, their own societies and their own states back from the ground up. So I think UN peacekeeping, which operates on the very simple principle of the responsibility to protect, has played a very useful role in all of these contexts that you talked about. Let me talk a little bit about this. The responsibility to protect in international relations is this very simple idea that, the primary responsibility of the protection of civilians in a particular country belongs to the government of that state. But if the government, for some reason, can't carry out that responsibility, then that falls on the international community to take that responsibility to protect civilians there. So when they don't have a choice. The United Nations is the only credible institution that can do that, because it has the mandate of 193 states when it goes in. So in that sense, I think it's been, you know, very useful. It has had its challenges, of course, but this is something that is kind of essential to some of the state building efforts that are happening in the continent.
How do you see proliferation of weapons coming out? The
non-proliferation of weapons, again, it's something that, you know, you have to look at it in different ways. So for weapons of mass destruction, we talked about, you know, that's, as far as chemical weapons are concerned, that's gone very well. It's, over 90% of all chemical weapons around the world have been destroyed. Very few countries stay out of that convention that have not signed it, just two or three. So for nuclear weapons, I mean, we're currently in a world that's sitting on over 20,000 active nuclear warheads for some reason, you know, which are not going to be used. There will be mutually assured destruction. So all common sense should prevail, and nuclear disarmament should move in the right direction. But what we really need to worry about, like I said earlier, WMDs are not actually being used in conflicts as much. It's the small arms that are really feeding into, you know, terrorism and civil conflict and ethnic conflict around the world. And there are, you know, hundreds of thousands of small arms in circulation, you know, in networks. So, for example, the recent small arms treaty has been a good step in that direction. And that is where we really need to address it, you know, whether civilians and, you know, the non-state actors should have access to small arms so easily that they're able to perpetuate these conflicts. So I think now that, you know, shifting focus, not only on WMDs, but also on these small arms and conventional weapons is really going to take this debate forward in a more, you know, proactive way.
We're talking of pollution, we're talking of climate, all this, have you even thought of what must be happening in Syria?
That's right.
Devastating effect.
Absolutely. I mean, we just spoke about the Sustainable Development Goals that has given, you know, the international community's efforts a distinctly sustainable direction. But other than that, the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals that just came to an end in 2015, they said a lot of countries that were not able to achieve these MDGs were because of the conflicts that set back development in these countries. So, you know, not just an impact on climate, but also an impact on, you know, resources, on the infrastructure of a country. I mean, if you look at some of the images that come out of something like Syria, you see decades and decades of, you know, industry and urbanization just completely wiped to the ground in a course of a few months. And that is, you know, really tragic. When you're talking about development and climate change and environment policies, how do you engage countries that have undergone such a scale of devastation, and where do you start talking about development for them is going to be a challenging issue going ahead.
A Herculean challenge, yes.
Absolutely.
And now let's look at the other major disasters that happen, like, you know, earthquakes. We had one in Nepal. How does UNESCO kind of organize itself to kind of foray into helping people? How do you do that? If you can, you know, share that with us.
I think the United Nations, through all its agencies, because it has such a diverse presence, responds to these disasters at a number of different levels. So you see the kind of needs that come out of an earthquake. For example, there would be disaster management itself. So, you know, rebuilding.
Rehabilitation.
There would be people who have been displaced, who can't return to their homes. So, you know, taking care of their needs.
No homes.
Yes, absolutely. Giving
shelter, food.
Giving shelter, giving
medicine.
Them the essential resources so that they're able to, you know, survive while they rebuild their lives. So a lot of UN agencies, UNHCR, the World Food Programme, UNESCO, all of them need to go in and start, you know, helping these societies rebuild. And disaster management in that sense has been a huge sort of world of different kinds of effort.
Nabila, tell us about the Sustainable Development Goals. You've worked with a lot of organizations.
So Sustainable Development Goals have been a very interesting effort in the life of the United Nations, because in the process of setting new goals on every issue for the next 15 years after the expiry of the Millennium Development Goals, what's really interesting is that sustainability is now at the core of every single one of these goals. So all our efforts towards equality, towards development, towards, you know, industrialization, education, all of these now have sustainability focus. So, you know, what we are looking now is not just being able to resolve these problems for this generation, but to be able to establish institutions and programs and policies that can carry the momentum that we get from them into the future. You know, sustainability is about development that you have for today that can be taken into the long term. I've worked with the UNESCO, and I was also privileged to be associated with a project called the Inclusive Wealth Index. So the Inclusive Wealth Report of 2014, on which I worked when I was working with UNESCO, is one such sort of a new way of looking at growth. And that's what the objective of the UN has been.
Tell us more about this.
So the Inclusive Wealth Index essentially looks at a new way of measuring growth and development in a country that goes beyond the GDP. Mm-hmm. Now, there's a lot of emphasis on the GDP as our main indicator of what, you know,
growth is.
Yes. Just the gross domestic product. But then it does look far beyond a lot of other things. For example, it doesn't tell us whether we'll be able to maintain this level of growth in the next 15 years or the next 30 years. Mm-hmm. And that is what inclusive wealth tries to do. You know, it tries to look at whether these gains are sustainable over the long term.
How do
whether
you know
we
that?
Are, so we measure things like our renewable resources, non-renewable resources. So for example, if your use of coal is feeding into a certain level of GDP now, and, you know, our measurement tells us that this coal is going to run out in the next
20 years.
Yes, 20 years. Then, you know, if you have 8 or 9% GDP now, you won't have 8 or 9% GDP after 15 years. And that's not very far off. That's not a very long, time off from here. It's coming. It's tomorrow. It's the next generation. So with the UN Sustainable Development Goals and with, you know, UN's efforts, for example, in things like the Inclusive Wealth Index, the effort is to try to maintain these gains for the future generations, you know, so that we don't leave the world in a state that, you know,
children in a better place.
Absolutely. So the children who grew up in the future then, you know, don't suffer because our development carried on a certain path that was very obsessed with certain numbers, you know, but also careful about whether these gains are distributed equally across different classes and different sectors, but also that they are distributed equally across different times of period in the future.
Educating the masses, educating the children. How do you look at human rights?
Human rights has been one of, you know, the biggest contributions of the world getting together, because that has really helped us establish certain fundamental obligations that we have towards all people of the world. So, you know, there are certain rights that are inalienable, and that has really changed the discourse from where we used to say that rights are for us to give to people to saying that these rights are naturally theirs. And what we have to do is basically make sure that nothing is done to take those away from them. Mm-hmm. The denial of those rights, I think, lies at the root of a lot of our conflicts and a lot of our problems and development challenges. And to have them as part of our education systems is absolutely crucial, because that awareness of basic human rights, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, in classrooms, even the youngest of students, I think that's really the theological text that they should be growing up with, should be the Universal Declaration of Human Rights.
Needs to be taken into account when you're making a new law as well.
Absolutely.
That if you're denying somebody and calling the person, putting the person behind bars for a certain age or whatever, mm-hmm. the person has rights as well. Are you giving him those rights as well?
Yeah, absolutely. The legal system, the educational system, whatever policy you make has to be guided by certain fundamental things that, are not open to negotiation. And, some of those are that people have certain, the right to life, the right to freedom, the right to equal, equality. Men and women have equal rights whenever you're designing a certain policy, etc. So I think human rights as a component of basic education is absolutely crucial.
Coming back again to education.
Yes.
What do you think about Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao? This is another lovely scheme that this government has come up with.
Absolutely.
And protecting the girl child and asking everybody to, put in their bit and to educate her. How do you see that coming up and shaping over the years?
A lot of work that has been done recently demonstrates amply that educating women has a force it's a force multiplier. It has a multiplier effect on all kinds of different things. Educated women are more likely to have healthier children. They are more likely to have more educated children. They are more likely to, if you educate a woman, if you educate a girl child, that has a lot of different benefits on society. And for that reason alone, something like this would be useful. But even apart from that, women as human beings should naturally have the right to better education just as any other group of society does, and therefore any law that encourages education among a group that has been denied so far equal opportunity for many different social, cultural, reasons is absolutely fantastic. And I'm quite hopeful about, this new policy that the government has come up with. Even Digital India, something like Make in India, for example, these are all these are the things that are really going to elevate India into a global platform, because they're all about looking inwards. A lot of the times we look at India's foreign policy as being something that's looking outwards currently, but if you really look at a lot of these laws and acts, you'll find that they're really drawing attention to what can be done here. How can we best build the potential of our own people? How can we bring industries into the country? Absolutely.
Everything.
How can we connect our countries better? How can we our country better? How can we equip people with things like education, with access to digital infrastructure, with better employment opportunities? So there is a lot of this is a very exciting time really for to look forward to the impact
next
that
millennium.
These policies
yes,
that's going to have both nationally and at the international level with the SDGs.
Yes. And playing out so well, with what you said about banning terrorism, banning chemical weapons. There is something in the United Nations headquarters which is a gun, and it opens out into a flower. So, and it reminds me of, Ruskin Bond, when he said, if mice could roar and elephants soar and trees grow up in the sky, if a song gave a shower and a gun grew a flower, this world would be nicer than most. So is that something like that at the headquarters? Have you seen it?
The UN headquarters has this, the monument that was built after John Lennon was assassinated was a gun that's, the nozzle is tied up into a knot, as to say that there's going to be no it's a symbol of disarmament, it's a symbol of peace, it's a symbol of also getting rid of the ideology that perpetuates violence in that sense. And I think that's something that is a message that not only needs to go out to people who are susceptible to violence, but I think that's also a message that needs to go out to people who are in the business of peace. We earlier talked about philosophers that have had an impact.
Kofi Annan.
Absolutely. And I talked about Rawls, I talked about Hobbes,
yes.
a little bit, but sometimes even very unexpected ones like Machiavelli, for instance, who you
yes.
would not expect,
ancient Machiavelli,
something like Sun Tzu, who was yes. a military strategist. So even when you look at some of his writings, has very important lessons, because he says victory in a particular war is not about prolonged operation, it's about victory itself. And I think the peace community too, you know, our international organizations, our NGOs, civil society who are working in peace, maybe need to, you know, think about the end goal of their work rather than trying to make careers out of being in these organizations. You know, it's very tempting to be in it because it's a fancy career option, but you also have to constantly remind yourself of the reasons why you got into doing this in the first place, which is, you know,
because violence is definitely not the answer.
Absolutely.
We're leaving nothing for our generation.
Absolutely. Violence is not the answer, and our engagement with violence also needs to go beyond, you know, being attacking it to being something that we address at a lot of different levels.
And, not just as a matter of saying it.
Absolutely.
We have to implement the same.
Absolutely. In development policy, in addressing terrorist ideologies, in addressing, you know, these channels of communication. The internet is now an open space. Children have access to whatever information they need. So how do we make sure that they're getting access to the right information? All of these things are going to have to be our arsenal when we are fighting something like armed conflict around the world.
But how do you see this conflict shaping out now, the present one?
In Syria? Well, that's something that, you know, the way it goes ahead is something that we hope that there's going to be a political solution, that, you know, all the parties are going to take the right steps going forward. As far as the chemical weapons disarmament there is concerned, you know, chemical weapons were taken out of that country and destroyed on board international waters. But even after that, the Security Council has recently established a joint mechanism that's going to identify the perpetrators of the use of chemical weapons in Syria. So it's going to try to find out who used them. And then the Security Council might, you know, decide on what to do with that information next. So there is a positive hope that something will happen, but the conflict has gone on for very long, and we are all, you know, equally disturbed about the kind of devastation that we've seen there, not just in Syria, but in so many other countries of the world. And the more dispersed something like this gets, the more you wonder whether these are all isolated things, or whether, like, you know, human trafficking or HIV/AIDS, we should treat this like one problem at the global level, and then see how all our agencies can have, you know, a lasting impact on trying to solve it.
You've been a prolific writer always. You've been writing for international journals. So were you also fond of reading, Nabila?
Oh, voraciously. I think that's what I spent most of my childhood doing, was, you know, buried inside piles of books. And I'm very fond of language in general. I think a lot of my interest in, you know, even in international politics, because I've also worked as a speech writer with the OPCW, and, you know, with my work that I've done in other places, has to do a lot with how language is used. So, you know, so some of my favorite writers are the very conventional ones. For example, love reading Shakespeare, just because of the way that he dealt with language. Mm. And then it also devolved into other languages as well. So for example, I translated a bit of poetry. I enjoyed reading Faiz Ahmed Faiz and his Urdu works when I was in college. So I published some of his translations that I did into English.
Or Omar Khayyam. You know?
Yeah, and that's also an interesting experience, because translating the same sentiment in different words across a different cultural experience that English
lends
has
a different
from Urdu,
meaning to the whole
it lends a different meaning to a different to that whole context. So, yeah, I mean, I've read a lot of these, you know, P.G. Woodhouse, Haruki Murakami.
Yes.
Those are some of my favorite writers. I read a lot of classics as well as contemporary literature, but more of the old old stuff.
And what about music or watching any special programs that you would care to talk about?
Yes, a lot of I have an interest in a lot of, like I said, as with literature, a lot of old things. I feel like I suffer a little bit from the golden age syndrome. So I listen to a lot of jazz, a lot of stuff from the 40s and 50s in the United States. That was, you know, the age of the Rat Pack and, you know, Frank Sinatra and Dino and all of those things. So that's where my music is, you know,
grounded, yes.
Grounded more in something that somebody of a much generation before me should be listening to. And same thing with the films as well. You know, I try to go as far back as, you know, I love Hitchcock's entire body of work. You know, a lot of these old films, the black and white era in Bollywood and Hollywood both. So.
McCavity, all these writers.
Absolutely. You know, anything that featured Humphrey Bogart and Ingrid Bergman, for example.
I'd like to end our conversation today, and thank you very much for joining us. It's been a real pleasure having you here, and we were privileged to share your views at Art Survey Day.
Thank you so much for having me here.